All right, greetings one and all, and especially to the Baptists on the back row. We're going to stand together and sing praises to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the first song is, Bless His Holy Name. How could you not? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. He that died my sin, He died for my sin. Died for my sin, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all within me, holy name. To God be the glory, great things He hath done. So loved He the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the
offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our victory, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen, amen. You can be seated. You sound good, masks and all. All right.
Morning, everybody. Glad you're here. Glad to see everyone. Thank you all for coming out last week to support the youth when they got back from camp. Since then, we've all rested a little bit, and we're glad to be here again. And most of them came back, so that's a good thing. I don't have too many announcements because we're kind of in that weird nebulous, like post camp, still COVID world that we live in, and so. But I do want to give you a few updates on things. One is Para Peru. If you haven't heard about them in a while. They've been doing a food ministry during the entirety of the quarantine where they give out bags of food to Venezuelans and Peruvians that just come and knock on the door. And there for a while they were serving 100 a day, usually more. And they were having to schedule it and contact people. And people were coming from hours away. They were walking. There was a guy who rode a bike with one leg. He was an amputee. And he came 4 hours away to get a bag of food. That's how dire things were there for a while. Things have kind of leveled off now, and it's still pretty rough there. The quarantine has been lifted, but you know, people are working less, and so hopefully they'll continue to do the food ministry. They've helped probably somewhere between, I don't want to misspeak, but somewhere around 3,000 people with bags of food, and they've been doing this for 100 days straight. Right now, if you will, pray for Lauren Robertson and the missionaries, or the Peruvians that she works with. They are dealing right now with one of them does have COVID, and the others are trying to quarantine to prevent that from happening. And if they do get diagnosed, that kind of pushes back their plans to continue giving food. Continue praying for that. And also consider maybe if it's in your heart to donate to them or to donate to Camp Copus, because unfortunately they had to cancel the Trek Week, which would have been, I think, this coming week. Just due to churches dropping out and just kind of the whole thing, they decided to quarantine and be off until August. And so they can really use your support. Obviously, the camps are how they fund and pay their staff and those sort of things. So without that, it's a pretty big financial hit. So you might consider giving to a place that has given a lot to us over the years. Other than that, just continue to pray for the youth. I'm seeing a lot of growth in them coming together. You know, they enjoy being around each other. We had a really big group come to the live. I think there was like 8 of us on Wednesday. And so moving forward towards school opening back up, it'll still be probably a while before we have Wednesday night services again. And so this is a pretty good alternative. And if you guys aren't tuning into the Facebook Live, you're missing out. It's a good time. We have a lot of fun, and we talk about like real stuff. It's not so goofy you can't watch it, but it is pretty goofy. And so, I'm just so thankful. Next month is coming up on 3 years of being here at Valley View, and it has been a ride. It has been incredible. I've loved every second of it. And just continue to pray for Glenn, pray for Rick and Chris and Tony and Jane and everyone who's working week after week to put together church so we can come and enjoy it in person. And I know they work really hard, and sometimes it can be a thankless job. Thank Isaac for always putting together the media for us. It takes a village to keep a church going, but you guys are incredible. And hope you look forward to, at the end of the service, we're gonna watch the camp wrap-up video. I tried to keep it as short as possible. 6 minutes. 6 minutes is the shortest I could get it. So, but again, thank you guys for being here. Thank you for being a church family, really being Christ-like in that aspect, and loving one another. And I'm going to pray, and I'll turn it back over to Rick.
Just one last thing. Uh-huh. Flowers here today were given in honor or in memory of Dorothy Daring, and so by Bill's brother, Don. He and I get to talk over the course of this last week. Neat guy. Appreciate him, but they wanted to send those flowers and ask them to be displayed here. Bill is here with us this morning. His birthday, he's 55 today, and so glad to see him here. And he asked this to be shared. Dear church family, my family and I want to thank each of you for your many acts of kindness during the recent loss of our loved one, Dorothy Daring. Thank you for your prayers, words of encouragement, phone calls, cards, visits, food to the home and lunch at the church, flowers, pallbearers, music, beautifully done by Tony Holland, and especially to Pastor Glenn for his wonderfully appropriate message from God's Word. I'm honored to be a part of this church family, and thank you for allowing me to be so. The Apostle Paul's words to the church at Philippi helped to express my feelings. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. With sincere love and appreciation, Bill Daring. And we were honored to be a part of the celebration of her life. Bill, it's great. Glad to have you here. Great to have you here.
Would you please pray? Let's pray. Father, thank you for this church family who comes together, and we surround our own, and we shower them with prayer, and we shower them with as many blessings as we can give, Lord. And we're thankful for the resources to keep the door open and the lights on when that's in the time in our nation right now where that is a struggle for some places, Lord. And we're so thankful for faithful stewards of your word, for people who volunteer and who do this job week after week. And we often forget how difficult it can be and how draining it can be and how much it requires of us, Lord. But I'm just so thankful for First Baptist Valley View and everything they've done for me personally, they've done for this youth group, and they've done for each other. And as we continue to grow, as we continue to overcome the dumpster fire that is 2020, Lord, we know that you have something incredible planned, Lord, and that we can't consider this year a wash until we've seen your plan fully realized. We continue to pray for those who are struggling with health, those who are struggling financially, those who are just struggling with depression and anxiety and those things that seem so common right now, Lord. We just continue to reach out to our families who are watching at home. We're thankful that they are being safe, but that they're also continuing to be with us. And we're extremely grateful to have them here with us this morning. We thank you and we love you for the salvation we know through Jesus Christ. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand together. We're going to sing Awake My Soul. It's a song you know and love.
For a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of his grace. A thousand songs are not enough to say how great you are. The glories of your majesty, the triumphs
your love. Awake my soul and sing the glories of my God and King. Arise and praise the one worthy of the songs of a thousand tongues.
Amen.
You break. You break the power of all our sin. You set the captive free. You make the broken heart rejoice. New life the dead receive. Awake my soul to sing the glories of my God. Arise and praise the one worthy of the songs of a thousand tongues. Forever you are, forever you are worthy, forever you are. Of a thousand tongues. Awake my soul to sing the glories of my God and King. Arise and praise the one worthy of the songs of a thousand tongues. Worthy of the songs of a thousand tongues.
Thank you. Be seated. Good to see you here. Got a sermon slideshow. Is it coming up? All right. glad you're here. Look forward to this time on Sunday mornings. Welcome the ones that are watching online. And we have quite a few that do that every Sunday. Others that watch later off the website or on YouTube. And so glad that you're with us this morning as well, but it certainly is good to see you. I can't tell you what a privilege it is to share week in and week out, I mean really what God places on my heart. I take it very seriously, but count it a very distinct privilege to do that. I thank you for your attention, and I'm glad you're here. With that in mind, I ask you to grab your Bible or your Bible app on your phone, or if you've got a tablet, whatever it may be. And join me in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to look at the first six verses in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 as the foundation for the message that God has placed on my heart today. Paul writes this letter to a church in the Greek city of Corinth. Now, some false teachers had come into this church and had created quite a stir in this body of believers there in the city of Corinth. They had attacked Paul's message, they'd attacked his ministry, they'd attacked his mission, they'd attacked his authority as an apostle of Jesus Christ, and they had caused many of the Christians in Corinth to doubt just about everything that Paul had taught them. And so, Paul writes this letter. He writes them to address the problems that they're having, to tell them again about the foundation for their very lives, the foundation of his ministry, the foundation of his message, the foundation of his mission, and really, like I said, the foundation of the very lives of those believers there in Corinth. And here in chapter 4, in the fourth chapter of 2 Corinthians, here we are, Paul tells them and us once again What is the foundation? He tells them that no matter what might be happening in their lives, he tells us, no matter what may be happening in our lives, if we claim to be followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we must continue to strive to see Jesus, to encounter him, to experience him. And we must base our lives on that vision, that experience, that encounter that we have with him. So here we are. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. Paul writes, "Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not ourselves, but Christ Jesus. But Jesus Christ is Lord, and ourselves as his servants, as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Jesus Christ." Now, I don't know about you, but I mean, this passage just absolutely pumps me up. In fact, I mean, as I read this passage, I can't help but see Paul lying there in the dust on the road to Damascus after having been knocked down by a brilliant flash of light. And here he tells the Corinthian Christians, and he tells us what he saw in that brilliant, dazzling flash of light: the glory of God shining in the face of Jesus Christ. And it's this experience, this vision of God's glory in Christ, that is the foundation, the basis for Paul's life, his ministry, his message. And Paul reminds his followers, the Christians there in Corinth, and he reminds believers that they too have experienced this vision, this encounter with Christ. And it's upon this vision, this experience, this encounter with him, that they have to focus the eyes of their lives. How they live comes from that encounter with Jesus Christ. And I believe that Paul is saying the same thing to us today. In these somewhat dark and difficult, confusing and complex times, that Paul is telling us this same vision of God's glory shining in the face of Jesus Christ must be the very foundation of our lives today. We must experience Christ constantly, continually, consistently. And this encounter must so invade, it must so pervade and penetrate every essence of our being that Jesus Christ and his purpose and his character motivate our every thought, our every word, our every action, so that he is clearly and vividly and urgently and lovingly and passionately portrayed to the world that is around us through our very lives. We are the ones that present him to this wounded and hurting, this dark and dying world. And what we present to him is what we have experienced, what we have seen in Jesus Christ. In order for our faith to be living and dynamic, as Paul says, we must see the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. We must focus our lives on the very essence of who Christ is and what we see in him. For seeing Jesus, I mean, we're convicted, we are cleansed, we are filled, we are set free, we are revived. Indeed, we are saved through what we find in Jesus Christ. Every aspect of the Christian experience is made real through personal experience with Jesus. Every aspect of the Christian life should be caught up in seeing Jesus, should come out of what we see in him, how we experience him. We would see Jesus, that is what we're needing. Strength, joy, willingness come within the sight. We would see Jesus dying, risen, pleading then welcome day and farewell mortal night. We must see Jesus. And we need to see Jesus rather than the delusions of this world, rather than the lies of this world. All right, let's see if we can. Ah. Yes, and we find the truth that Jesus himself offered here in thinking about where our foundation is and the fact that we must see Jesus rather than the delusions of this world, the lies of this world. What did he tell his disciples here? He says, I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Every aspect of our lives should be shaped by what we see in Jesus Christ. But frankly, many of us, in fact, I mean, many of us who are Christians, even many of us who have been Christians for a long time, we have our lives more shaped by what we see in this world, by the standards of this world and the values of this world, rather than we do by the one that we call Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. For many of us, our values, our lifestyles, our pattern of behavior, our relationships, our reactions, our very life is more formed by the world that is around us, by the enemy who confronts us, or by our own sinful nature, than by the living Lord. We must see Jesus, though, rather than the lies of this world, rather than the one who tells us lies, rather than our flesh that would deceive us, we must see him. It's so easy for us, myself included, to get caught up in a search for success and for safety. And we can get so caught up in that search that we lose sight of salvation and security that is found only in Jesus Christ. Oh, that we would see Jesus rather than the delusions of this world, rather than the lies of this. He is the truth, and only his truth can set us free from the law of sin and death. We must see Jesus in the face of the one who delivers us into eternal life. Today, we must see Jesus. We must see Jesus rather than the divisions of this world that separate us. And in Galatians, Paul writes these words: there is neither Jew nor Greek, there's neither Jew nor Gentile, pardon me, neither slave nor free, there's neither male nor female. We are all one. You are all one in Christ Jesus. We need to see Jesus rather than the divisions of this world. Now, we live in a broken, absolutely, and fragmented world. It's always been broken and fragmented. The times we are living in now show really just how broken and fragmented this world really is. This world has always been polarized into different groups and different camps, groups that war and hate and fight and kill one another. Even among followers of Christ, there are deep divisions, some of them theological, some of them cultural, some of them personal, and way too many of them are political. And these divisions have created wounds and injury, and they continue to drain our energy and to sap our strength. And that's where I have found myself way too often over the course of these last several weeks. Caught up in all of the worry and stress about the divisions that are all around us. Stressing out about that, divisions in our communities, division in our nation, divisions in the world, divisions among members of this very own congregation. And my energy was sapped and my strength was depleted, absolutely. And then a friend sent me a link to a sermon that had convicted him about where he needed to be, where we might need to be in terms of refocusing our attention, and certainly mine. I listened to that sermon. I cried. I prayed. I changed my focus. Well, actually, I asked God and gave him permission to change my focus, to reorient me as to where my priorities and focus should be in this time.
back on Jesus Christ. And the reality is, if we focus our attention on that which binds us together, instead of on that which separates us, if we'll determine to pray for one another, especially those who think differently than we, those who act differently than we, those who look differently than we do, if we'll commit ourselves to praying for them, if we'll determine to love one another, to think the best of one another, to be kind to one another, God can and will bind up and heal those wounds. If we will be ones who will do those things instead of complain and criticize and tear down one another, God will work His healing power in our lives, in those wounds and those struggles. Okay, so what is it that binds us together as followers of Jesus Christ? Pretty simple. Christ Himself. A vision of Him. He is the foundation of our fellowship. For we, followers of Jesus Christ, should be the very focal point of our lives. Jesus Christ. And friends, if we will just think about it, look at it, spend a little time with it, pray about it, we're going to realize that we agree on a whole lot more than we disagree. You know, now, we are going to disagree about a lot of things, absolutely, related to living and serving in this confusing and this unsettling world. And yes, and though each one of us, we must speak and act according to the dictates of our own conscience, the final solution to these problems will not be us as men and women coming together and you know, logically and you know, reasoning with one another. That's not the answer. It will come only as we focus together on the source and the foundation of our very lives, Jesus Christ. What I pray for and what I seek in my own life is a fresh, sovereign work of the Holy Spirit that will focus my life on Jesus. What I pray for, what I hope for our church family, for our community, our state, our nation, our world, is a fresh, sovereign work of the Holy Spirit that would then help us to focus corporately on the Lordship of Jesus. He is the author and finisher of our faith. Our challenge as followers of Jesus Christ is absolutely to be alert, to be aware, to be informed, and to be involved in the issues of this world, absolutely, but we must not let anything take our eyes off of Jesus. We mustn't let anything make us cynical or hateful or doubting or disillusioned or despairing. We must see Him. We must focus our lives, our hearts, our attention on Him. We must see Jesus rather than the delusions, the lies of this world. We must see Jesus rather than the divisions in this world that want to separate us. And we must see Jesus rather than the disappointments of those that are around us. Disappointments of others. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8, we find these wonderful, amazing, staggering words. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the one that we absolutely can count on, no matter what. We've felt let down by others, all of us have. We've been hurt by those that we've trusted. We know what it's like to you know, for someone that we love, someone that loves us, to feel that someone has either betrayed us personally or betrayed that in which we believe. We all know what that is like. To be hurt, to be disappointed by other people. And the reality is, as long as we are in this world, we will be hurt. We will be disappointed by the people that are around us. That's the truth. Some of us have been hurt and disappointed, and we haven't been able to let go of that hurt or disappointment. We carry resentments, we carry hurt feelings, we carry grudges. We just can't seem to let them go. And they drag us down, and they hinder us from doing what God has called us to do. Friends, we need to see Jesus rather than the hurts, rather than the disappointments of the other people around us. He wants us to get rid of that baggage that keeps us from truly fellowshipping with Him. He wants us to cast all our cares upon Him, because He truly cares for us. The disappointments will be there. People will hurt you and disappoint you. But friends, Jesus never fails, never disappoints. When we come to Him, and that is the joy that we find in these words, at least I certainly do, that Jesus is the same. He can be counted on. His faithfulness is forever. The same yesterday, today, and forever. And what He tells us, we are more than conquerors through Him who set us free, the one who loved us and died for us. He has made us more than conquerors through Him. All things are possible through Jesus Christ. He is for you and not against you. In your Father's house, there is a place for you. You are a child of God. Yes, you are. That's the truth that we know. That's where our focus and foundation must be. Our faith, our very life, must be founded in Jesus Christ. Our focus must be on Him. Not on the delusions or the lies of this world, not on the divisions that seek to separate us, not on the disappointments of those who are around us, but on Christ Himself. The one that we find here, the one I pray that you know is here, inside of you, because you've given your heart and life to Him. He's still there whether you've pushed Him to the side, whether you've let your pain be a prison, or you're going to use it to be a platform to show who this God is. Whether you're going to trust Him to do what He said He's going to do, or you're going to try to do it yourself, whether you're going to seek fame, or whether you're going to be faithful to what He has equipped you and called you to do. Friends, we must see Jesus. I hope that you know Him personally. I hope that you've seen Him with a eyes of your heart and life, and you've said, Jesus, you are everything. I want you to be in charge of my life. And I want the world to know that you are the source of life and hope, that you're the same, that we can trust you, that you are true. I hope that that is your testimony today and in the days ahead. That He will be your focus, not what rages around us. And I'm not saying to act oblivious. We must stay alert, aware, informed, involved, just like I said, absolutely. Speak and act according to the dictates of your conscience, but I pray that your conscience is one that's informed and formed by Christ Himself. And that He's the one whose truth that we should be seeking to advance. If you don't know Jesus, I want to talk to you about Him. I can't help myself. Let's pray together. Father, thank You for loving us. Thank You that we can know that love because of Your Son, Jesus Christ. In this passage that we looked at in 2 Corinthians, those six verses there in chapter 4, and I mean Paul reminding those Corinthian Christians and reminding us today that our focus must be on that life-changing vision that we've had of You. Your glory found in the face of Jesus Christ. And let us be ones who seek that in Your word, seek that as we serve together, and then we're prepared to share it because we just can't help ourselves. Thank You. Father, if there's anyone here that has been hurt, that's carried a grudge, those hurt feelings and disappointments, Father, I pray that today begin that process of turning that over to You, letting it go to You, casting their cares on You. Father, and I thank You for the healing that You will continue to bring in their hearts and lives. Father, for divisions that separate us. I'm not saying we're not all going to agree on everything, Father, but let us at least agree on your love for us through Jesus Christ. And then let us be ones who show that love as we love on each other, as we care for each other, as we think better of others than we do of ourselves, as we're kind and compassionate to those around us because of your kindness, your compassion, your love for us. And let us be committed to the truths that we know that are found only in you and your word. Thank you for being here today, Holy Spirit, as you lead and guide us into all truth. Let us be ones who clearly show the world who you are as we love on each other and as we love you. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now you heard a little bit about camp last week. Now you're going to get to see just how, I want to say blessed it was, but really it's kind of crazy. So anything else, Houston?
Nope. All right. I'll let the video speak for itself.
You hit these lights.
Thank you.
Continue to pray for them. Continue to pray for us as a church family as to how God wants to, you know, use them to impact us. I hope that you have a blessed week. Anything that we need to be aware of, how we can pray for one another. Yes, as Houston talked about, praying for Camp Copus. And so please, yes, remember those. We employ, it's about 60 at Camp Copus. I'm on that board of directors, and so... pray for us as we make decisions related to lots of different people. Others that we need to be made aware of. All right, well, let's pray together and we'll be dismissed from the back like we have been. And so, Brock, would you pray as we go this morning, please?
Yes, dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for Glen sharing out his heart. Please let everyone be able to take away from this. Please let everyone go home, have a blessed day. Bless this week. Please help Camp Copus and Paraguay, but all these places, just get help to those who need it in a time of need, Lord. Just please bless those who need help during COVID. Just bless us all today. In his name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.